For Coconuts TV today is Jean Comer. Now it's safe to say that Jean is a long-term fan, and we'll find out a little bit about that as time goes on. Now, I know you still come and see United occasionally, even though you live some distance from Cambridge at the moment. Where do you actually live?
We live in Sheffield.
So you live in Sheffield, you see some games during the season, and you still visit Cambridge?
Yes. We go to quite a few away games as well. We've already been to Grimsby,
yeah.
Mansfield, and Port Vale this season. As well as, I think, two or three home games.
Portville.
Yeah.
Enough said. Okay, Jean, let's go back to the start. Tell me where you were born, and if you're willing to tell me which year you were born, that'd be great as well.
Right, I was born in 1937, and I was born in Cambridge.
Right.
And I lived just this side of Whitehill Road, on Market Road, where I lived until I first got married.
Okay, so
my parents lived there all their lives until they got married.
Good, so you were within shouting distance really of the Abbey from birth, really?
Well, we were in listening distance because when we didn't have phones then, of course, and when Cambridge United played away, if they'd won, they always used to play "I've Got a Lovely Bunch of Coconuts."
Okay.
And if we opened our back bedroom window, we could hear it through, so we always knew if they'd run away from home or not.
Now, you sort of mentioned to me that there was a story about a bell. Used to ring occasionally, remember?
Yes, we got friendly with a fireman. I believe his name was Peter Hurst, and he worked at the fire station. It was a fire station on the corner of Newmarket Road and Coldings Lane, mm-hmm. and he managed to acquire one of those big bells, you know, that you used to ring. And we used to have it at the match, and we used to put it on the rail. And so every time we scored, we were able to ring this bell.
Brilliant. So all people round about could tell if Cambridge United had scored.
Well, I'm not sure if people outside the ground, but all the people in the ground would know.
Yes,
and probably those on the allotments.
And I think we'll talk about the allotments as time goes on. So tell us about your first memories of the Abbey then, Jean, because obviously you started when you were very young.
Yes.
So who would have brought you along to games at that time?
My brother. I first came to a game with my brother.
Uh-huh.
And I think it must have been around 1948, 49.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was probably about 12 at the time.
So that would still be in the...
I believe they were in the United Counties League, but I'm not sure how clear my memory is then. I don't think they were in the Eastern Counties League because I can remember Bill Whittaker coming.
Ah, okay. Good. So 48-49 is probably about as far back as we've got in terms of people we've spoken to.
All right.
So what's the ground like at that time? Presumably it wasn't as built as it is now.
No. There was a little wooden hut on the far side where the Habin stand is, by the halfway line, where the teams used to come out. It had a little wooden fence around it. And we used to stand between that hut and the corner flag. And I think it was Mrs. Harrison who used to run the canteen.
Lil Harrison.
I can't remember what her first name was, but she was always there running the canteen. And we used to stand near the rail. I think it was just cinders and planks along there at the time. And then this side, where the new stand is, there was just sort of a small wooden stand.
Yeah.
And that was it. Everywhere else was flat apart from over the other side where it's a bit raised.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the Corona, I can't call it Newmarket Road, it's still the Corona end as far as I'm concerned. And I think it must have been in the 1950s when that stand was built. And I can remember we had a big gale and the roof was lifted up.
Yes.
And part of the trouble was they hadn't left a vent at the back for the wind to go through. And I believe that was in the early 50s.
Yeah, we've certainly heard about that event. Now you talk about it, it's funny because many long-term supporters still call it the Corona End.
Yeah.
Why was it the Corona End?
Because the Corona company, where the car park is, there was a Corona factory,
and
they used to bottle all the drinks. And when you walked by, you could see them all going around on the bottling all the drinks. And that's where the car park is, and I think probably the support. I think it went almost up to the back of where the original clubhouse was.
Okay. So there was, I don't think you remember this, but there was a big house was at the very front of the ground next to the Corona Works, but that possibly was gone by the time.
I can't recall that, no.
Fair enough, that's fine. No, we don't know when it went, and that's the thing, and we have no photographs of it, so we know that. Okay, so you came with your brother,
yes.
You said? Was it just the one brother you had?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So was he a regular?
Yes, he came regularly.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So
he was actually at school with Colin Proctor.
Oh, right.
They used to play football together.
Yeah.
So Colin tells me.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So he was really, as Colin grew into the club as well over many years. Did your brother stay with the club or did he move?
No, unfortunately my brother died 40 years ago.
Okay.
He did support him up until that time though.
Yes.
He carried on with him in Cambridge.
Yeah. And you still lived in Cambridge, you said you lived in Newmarket until you were married?
Yes.
Ah, so when would you have moved to Sheffield?
1975,
okay. 76. 76.
It's February 76,
to
be precise.
He's going to keep you right on this, isn't he? Good.
Okay, good. My son still come regularly, my son still support, they come down from Sheffield as well.
Oh, Joseph. How many sons do you have?
I have two sons, yeah.
That's good. Both supporters as well. Fantastic. Okay, let's go back to the times that you were watching in your early days, and try and think of some of the players you might have seen, you know, not necessarily in your very first season or thereabouts, but in your first few seasons.
Well, I particularly remember the Gallagher brothers. I can't tell you exactly what years they were, and at that time we had the Bishop brothers playing in the same team as well. Russell Crane and Albert George and all these sort of people. And I remember Arthur Morgan used to play in goal sometimes, and he was a groundsman on Parker's Piece.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Did you know Russell Crane at all? Because Russell, of course, lived locally as well.
I know, I was at the match when he had an award, or it was his birthday last season.
Oh, yes.
I didn't know him personally.
Yeah, he's a lovely man, and we knew him really well in Coconuts.
I particularly remember Wilf Mannion, because that was a bit later, but he just lived up Newmarket Road.
So tell us a little bit about that then. You say he lived just on Newmarket Road.
On Newmarket Road, just before it's Quainton Close, I think. On Newmarket Road.
Okay. And he was here for a few seasons?
Two seasons.
Did you ever get to meet him at all?
No.
We've been told he was a very, very quiet man.
He was very, very smart. He always used to seem to wear a suit when I saw him walking along to the ground.
Because that would be the thing in those days, I guess, you would see players more than you would today. You know, you'd see players walking to the game, on bicycles perhaps, down at the games, things like that. Yeah. Now, interestingly, you said to me that you had one piece of the programme which talked about, not a car park.
It's actually I have bought some old programmes that I managed to find, and it's a little piece about the club now providing cycle places for people to park their cycles in the ground. And will you please not keep parking your bicycles against people's wooden fences, because they've been complaining.
You can imagine players arriving on bicycles today and slightly, there's not so much, even in Cambridge. Okay, so that's your early days in Wilf Mannion. Did you have any thoughts about Wilf as being an exceptional player at that time?
Well, I always say he could beat three players without touching the ball, and he used his body very well. And uh-huh. He was very tiny, he was quite small as well.
Is he a small man?
It was quite sad though, because as far as I recall, when he stopped playing for Cambridge United, he took over the pub and went bankrupt, and then he went back to Middlesbrough and ended up working in the steelworks again.
I believe he did come back to Middlesbrough indeed. I didn't know the part about the pub. Do you know which pub it was?
Somewhere beginning with H, I'm not sure if it's Haddon or Hastingfield. It's somewhere like that.
Yeah, I think Hastingfield is the one I'd
heard.
We can check that out. And it'll be in, as a little plug, it'll be in Andrew Bennett's book, inevitably.
Oh, right.
Okay, so moving forward through the 50s, you stayed a fan once, you'd be hooked almost immediately.
Oh, yes. I saw programmes.
Oh, okay.
There were about four or five of us. Pat Woolley, whose father, Jack Woolley, was the director of the club. Yeah. And my friend Dorothy Rigby and Sylvia Leader and Sheila Ludkin, my friend Janet, we all saw programmes together. And that's how I remember when Bill Whittaker first came player manager. Uh-huh. He scored a goal in the first match, which was about 35 yards. It was a brilliant goal.
Yeah, one you remember forever.
Yes, and when they had his benefit, we were selling programmes, and I think it was one of the largest crowds we had. They let us stand in this wooden enclosure in front of a little hut, and we stood next to Sam Barton all the time and got his autograph on the programme, which I brought to show you if you're interested.
We were selling
interested. That was 1954.
Oh, goodness. Yeah.
So he must have become manager in 51, perhaps. I think it might have been the second year that became Cambridge United.
Yes, because that was the changeover then from RB when you started.
Yes, to Cambridge. Yes.
Was there ever a reason given why they changed to Cambridge that you heard?
I'm not sure, but I was very disappointed that I preferred Abbey United. Partly because it's Abbey area and I didn't like Cambridge City, and I thought people might mix us up. Cambridge City then were quite a big team in the theme of the league.
Yes. And always with a really nice ground. That was the big distinction. That plus the amateur stakes as well. as you would have seen then, the time when Cambridge United increasingly became more professional. Yes. You mentioned people like Bob Bishop, who was one of the first players to be paid.
Oh, was he? Right.
Well, yeah. And we spoke to Bob a couple of years ago before he died. And yeah, so the two clubs in the city were interesting because they diverged quite a lot, didn't they? The city were north of the city and amateur. But did you notice at the time how Cambridge United were moving in a more professional way?
Yeah, well, they were both in the Southern League. Yes. They were both in the Southern League. Cambridge City always had much larger crowds.
Yes.
What I first noticed was a change in the crowds going to the different matches. Mm-hmm. Cambridge United gradually overtook Cambridge City.
Okay. So previously, had it been the other way around?
Yes, Cambridge City had much bigger crowds than Abbey United and Cambridge United.
Indeed. Keep me right. Okay. So we've moved into the 50s, we've got the change towards professionalism, we've got Abbey United to Cambridge United. You would start to see changes in the ground then, because you mentioned the Little Hut.
Yeah.
So what other changes, you know, did that disappear? Did that move anywhere else? Did the changing rooms move?
There was a gap really. After I had my children, they were born quite close together. I wasn't quite so involved with the club then. So my memories there aren't quite so clear as they were before. Mm-hmm. They are now. But I think the first thing I remember was the stand on this side. Well, it's not the stand now, the stand's got bigger, but there was a slightly bigger stand on this side.
And of course they built the bigger stand behind the old living room.
Yes. I can't recall quite, but I mean, one of the things I really liked then, period we've been talking about, we always used to come out to the post-horn gallop.
Yes.
To come out to the post-horn gallop, and I would really like that to, it was quite rousing bit of music.
Yep, absolutely. And now it's changed again.
Yes, and it was that little square block on the corner where all the, by the side of the, where the, by the side of where the disabled.
Yes, yeah.
The top
which were the changing rooms?
No, that's where they used to make all the announcements from.
Oh, yes, yeah, the tavern. Yes. And I believe the changing rooms were actually underneath, which is now the toilets.
Yes,
yeah. Okay, good. So you have seen lots of changes to the ground.
Yes.
And then as we moved into the 60s again, as moving forward all the time, as we moved into the 60s, the club started to build. Mm-hmm. And the ultimate aim was to move to part-time or full-time professional, but certainly in the Football League. So what do you remember about the 60s? Because that seems to have been a period when the club itself changed fundamentally.
I can't quite remember where the managers were then, but I remember Bill Leavers.
Yes.
And I'm not sure if that was the 60s or the 70s.
He was.
And Bill Leavers signed Brendan Batson.
Yeah.
From Arsenal. And we understood that Arsenal at that time didn't play any black players in their first team.
Mm.
And I met Brendan Batson about, I'm a trustee in Sheffield and the Football in Knights Race and Divides.
Uh-huh.
We've been working with young black people and refugees about integrating them into football, because if you can't speak English,
yes,
you can play football, because whatever nationality you are, you can actually play football together. Yeah. And it's a very good way of integrating young people. And Brendan Batson was at this dinner, and I went up to him and said, I think I'm the only person who watched your first game for Cambridge United. And I thought we signed you for £5,000, and he gave me a great look and said, well, they told me it was £6,000. But most people think it was Ron Atkinson who signed him, but it was Bill Leavers.
Okay, so you talked about Bill Leavers, who he fundamentally changed the attitude of the club.
Mm-hmm.
Internally, as opposed to financially, because financially, through Dudley Arliss and others, they had become quite financially secure at that time. And then Bill Leavers came along and he said, I believe one of his statements was he would have us in the Football League within 3 seasons. So do you remember much about Bill or at that period, late 60s, early 70s?
I remember getting into the Football League, because
uh-huh.
I remember we replaced Bradford Park Avenue, and Bradford Park Avenue was the first league team that we actually beat. And I believe they were in Spain at the time, and I remember them coming back and having an open-top bus tour around the marketplace. But before that, I understood that the club had applied several times, but they used to invite the London clubs that were playing in Ipswich and Norwich to drop off in the supporters club for doing, they built up relationships with different clubs at that time, inviting them into the club group, so yeah. That helped get them a few more votes.
And inevitably the directors would speak to directors.
Yeah,
so talking about that sort of time, one of our favourite players from the 60s was Rodney Slack. He still is. Yes. He's one of the coconuts.
Oh right, yes.
Do you remember Rodney as the goalkeeper?
Yes, I remember him, yes.
Well, he still lives in Newmarket Road.
Oh right.
So he's never moved. Right. No. He doesn't like to admit it, but he's from Peterborough.
Oh right, gosh. I remember going there to see Cambridge United play Peterborough Reserve, so I think they've come a long way since then.
Yeah, I think they have come a long way since then.
There was a goalkeeper who had TB, wasn't there?
Yes, there was. He took over from Rodney.
Yes, and they had a very nice testimonial for him just before he died.
As Alan said, it was Trevor Roberts who took over. Yeah. But sadly, within I think 2 seasons, he passed.
I remember Hutchinson, who had that incredibly long throw.
Yeah, he moved to
Chelsea.
And of course, what part of the transfer deal was that Chelsea would come here and play?
They agreed to come and play that season, and that season they won the FA Cup.
Sure.
And they actually came round with the FA Cup, and I think that was the largest attendance at the ground.
Yeah.
And they walked around with the cup.
Were you there on that night, or did you not?
Yes, I was there. Yeah. Very exciting, yeah.
I bet it was. Mm. I bet it was. They had some players at that time, including Hutchison, Osgood, and others.
Dion Dublin, he was a bit later, I believe, wasn't he?
It was so. Let's keep on moving forward then, because the 70s was essentially a time of consolidation in the league for the club. But as we moved forward into the 80s, we started to see very big clubs coming. Late 70s, 80s, we would play Newcastle, for example. We'd play Sunderland. We'd play a lot of.
Were you
teams.
In Division Two?
Exactly.
And you actually above Sheffield United in Division Two at one time. And you played us on Boxing Day and Street scored a fantastic goal at Bramall Lane. I think it was 2-2 the score.
And there you go. Which sort of year would that be, any ideas? Era, maybe?
It would have been in the 70s, because I think my brother was still alive then, and he was at the manager.
Before 79?
Yeah, before 79.
It was 3 each at Bramall Lane, Boxing Day. Floyd Street scored.
There you go. Yeah. So was that a bit of a difficult one for you?
No, I was really pleased to see the game was up there. We followed them quite a lot in the cup. We were at Leicester when we thought they might get promoted because they were playing Leicester off the pitch.
Yeah.
And then they lost 5-2. I don't know. Leicester scored so many goals in the second half. It was absolutely incredible. Whereas Cambridge could have been 3 up at half time.
John Beck had to change.
I can't remember what year they were.
No, you're right. That was the playoff for the Premier the inaugural Premier.
Yeah.
Things change.
I know.
Things change. And then Leicester go on to win it 2 years ago. Cambridge are in the fourth division.
Well, we were at the first playoff at Wembley, where Brian Dean scored. No, Dublin scored.
Against Chesterfield.
1-0. Well, we were the only car, I think, going along the M1 down to London with Cambridge United flags as we went by Chesterfield.
Yeah, I was on the bus. So let's go to the sort of almost the glory times, which were the early to mid 1990s, and you've mentioned Dion Dublin. You remember any other players from that sort of era? Because
it was Sinton, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And
he was just a little bit earlier, but you're right.
Yeah.
But the
there was another player I think played for Sheffield. Had to play for Sheffield Wednesday as well. I can't quite recall.
Mm. Oh, there are many.
Yeah.
Right. Let's think then on
but Kitson was later, wasn't he?
He was. Dave Kitson was just a little. Think about your own life then. When did you move to Sheffield? When did you tell us you moved?
In 1976.
Okay, so how hard did you find it then to decide to keep supporting Cambridge, but to actually go and see them on occasions as well? Was that a conscious decision?
No, I probably didn't see them for 2 or 3 years after we first moved.
Yeah.
Because we were sort of settling down. And we only lived 10 minutes walk from Sheffield United's ground, so we like football. So.
Yeah.
Our family
split,
so I went to Sheffield United,
so I went to
Sheffield Wednesday.
Good stuff. Okay, let's bring you slightly more up to date then and come towards where we are today, because we've got lots of stories about the 90s and early 2000s. During the conference years, for example, did you still take an interest in Cambridge United even though they were down in the 9 years?
Yes, we used to watch them in the conference.
So you still kept it even then, because that would have been the team that I would have
that
expected.
That would have been the playoff when they got from conference into the
Yeah, we had three playoffs, didn't we? Yeah.
You were at Wembley too as well, yeah, when we lost.
We've been to all the playoffs at Wembley.
Yeah, so Exeter Torquay. Yeah, 2-0, what was it, 1-0, 2-0?
In fact, we only had shirts printed, there were about 18 of us. White t-shirts. My son did this, and it was decided everybody would have a name of the player on the back. So we all sat together, named the place, and mine had Mannion on the back.
Oh, there you go.
I've still got it at home.
And then were you there the day against Gateshead?
Sorry?
Were you there for the playoff final against Gateshead?
Yes,
we were.
And how long did that 10 minutes or 14 minutes of injury time take?
Ages.
Someone described it as the 10 minutes that took 2 weeks.
Right. We're used to that though, watching Sheffield United, because they had never yet won a playoff.
Never scored a goal.
Never scored a goal.
The team is coming. Okay, so do you still...
Unfortunately though, when Sheffield United came to play Cambridge in the FA Cup, we were staying with a friend in Paris, so unfortunately we couldn't get to that game.
Well, staying in Paris isn't too bad a company.
We hoped it might be a draw, so you can get back to Bahrain.
Okay, we're not going to go on much longer because the team is restricted. But you still come and see, how many games would you say you saw in a season?
It varies. About seven.
About seven, yeah.
Seven or eight.
That's more than a lot of fans who live locally, I would say, to be honest. But even though the team, you've seen a lot of ups and downs with the team, you know, really good teams and not so good teams, but you still come along. What do you think brings you back?
I don't know. I think once you've supported a team, you always support them, particularly your hometown team, sort of sentiment as much as anything else. You sort of, theirs is always the first result we look at half time, see what's going on.
Yeah. So, Junior, tell me about your dad and the allotments. There were stories associated with that.
Yeah, I have to admit, my father was chair of the allotments.
Okay.
And every time the club were putting the planning application to build the allotment stand, he was one of the most vociferous objectors to it. And he tells me at the time when balls used to go over, the guys who had the allotments there used to hang on to them. They used to refuse to send them back. But it was at that time we were quite friendly with Jack Woolley, and one time we'd just been on a holiday down to near the Isle of Wight, I think near Bournemouth somewhere, and about shortly afterwards they ran this big article in the paper about my father chair of the allotment society, Jack Woolley being big enemies, you know, and actually they were quite friendly. Mm-hmm. It was just because my father supported the club, but he was adamant, he had the allotments all sorted out during the war, and he was quite certain that the club could not take them. But we did come to, I think we were playing, I was at Burnley, I think, and the pro got up about three or four months after my father died. Uh-huh. And there was a big red card in, and you had to hold it up when the referee blew his whistle to object to the council, because I had to pass by an identity, and I thought my father would be turning his grave. That's a funny story. Yeah,
so what did the club want to do? Because obviously now that we've got that big stand.
Yes, that's built on part of the allotment.
It is.
The fortunate thing is, when the club were in difficulties, I paid my £10 for a seat, and they put it on the allotment end, which I had to change to another stand because there's no way I'm going to sit on the allotment end.
Understand.
But I can't, it was quite surprising really.
Good. So did they finally come to a compromise between the allotment holders and the...
Well, that was after we were in Sheffield, so yes. I can't tell you about that. But obviously, is this a nice stand there? I must admit, it improves the ground quite a lot.
It is, although there are always complaints that it's too far away from the
place. Oh, yes, because it's that big bit in the front, is it, where they can run up and down the train.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. The one story we heard, which we always like, is that on occasions the ball would go over into the allotments, and the allotment holders would throw back a cabbage.
I can imagine that.
That just sounds so Cambridge to me.
Yeah, yeah, so that's quite interesting. I know at one time they did want to make a main entrance to the ground from Elfleda Road for the supporters to come in and not, you know, right through to the ground.
A little story that Bill Weavers told us was that the manager's house was the one which actually backs on to the ground. He said, and he realised on a Saturday that many of the fans would just walk down the Fleet Road, cut through his garden and play in the field. So that was one of the first things he ever
understood.
Oh, good. Gina, I hope you come to see Cambridge United for many, many years to come. And I told you it would fly fast, didn't I? I told
you
it
would go really fast.
That's probably somewhere between 20 minutes and half an hour or thereabouts. But Thank you very much for your time, and it's been great to speak to you.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.